Hello and welcome to the special edition of Greater Somerville. I'm Joe Lynch. My guest today is a Democratic candidate for governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Bob Massie, a Somerville resident, activist, entrepreneur, environmentalist, and corporate watchdog. Bob has spent over 30 years advocating for corporate accountability, global sustainability, and local prosperity. He is a former candidate for lieutenant governor of Massachusetts and makes his home with his family in the Winter Hills section of Somerville. It is my pleasure to welcome Democratic Party candidate for governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Bob Massie.
Thank you, Joe.
It's been a long time in coming, Bob Massie.
It sure has. It took us longer than it should.
We're pseudo neighbors.
Yes.
We both live in the Winter Hill section of the city.
Yeah.
We've seen each other over the years.
That's true. I've admired your show for a long
time. There you go. Thank you very much. But now you're here.
Here I am.
In the official capacity as one of the nominees for governor.
One of two. Isn't that amazing?
One of two.
It's either going to be him or me. So
one of two.
It.
And I always give credit to and name them by name. Jay Gonzalez was here on Greater Somerville earlier in the spring.
Good for him.
Both of you have been campaigning nonstop.
Absolutely.
And I have the pleasure of Bob Massie is the first and only to date gubernatorial candidate who has ever appeared on Henderson Street in my neighborhood.
And I have to tell you, that was actually serendipity. It was just by luck. I was not seeking you out, Joe, to knock on your door.
We're never going to get over that, Bob, because all
true.
Of my neighbors that you met said, was that an accident? And I said, no, it wasn't an accident. They have their neighborhoods all plotted
out,
which ones that they want to go to.
That's
so
true.
Thank you for that.
Oh, well, listen, I enjoy it, and it's key to winning. I mean, you got to be in front of people. I'm very lucky because I've got really hundreds of folks all over the state. One guy, who's just an incredible supporter has already knocked on 500 doors by himself. So we're feeling good. The campaign is moving forward, but there's a lot at stake. And so we'll see what happens.
Your campaign workers, I was very, very happy to see the youth.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not that we're aging, Bob, but...
I'm aging.
I'm aging as we speak. I was so happy, this young crowd that's coming in to politics. I am overjoyed to see the enthusiasm, to see how dedicated they are. And your campaign volunteers were right there with you last
week. I mean, let's face it. What we're doing now is not working for them today, and it's not going to work for them in the future. And, they're realizing it. And it didn't take Trump to get them started. Obviously, people were excited about Bernie. But honestly... not that long ago, I was down on the Cape. I was talking to a bunch of voters about what they think the role of a governor is. And one woman said, the role of a governor is to look into the future, see what's coming at us, and help us to prepare. And that, I think she got it exactly right. That's the spirit of Massachusetts. The folks who came here were not just focused on what happens today and tomorrow. They were looking into the future. That's what it means to be an American. And we have lost that capacity in many places. And certainly, we don't have a governor now who's thinking about the future.
The intro says you've been at this for over 30 years.
Yeah.
I don't think I have to explain to anybody in Somerville who you are.
Yeah.
But for those folks who are going to see this on the web and they're going to see it in other distribution channels, if you could just touch on some of the milestones in your own life and why you are so passionate about the things you're passionate about.
Well, Joe, something about me that really explains a lot of this, and that's because when I was a kid, I was born with a serious illness called hemophilia. And what it meant is I couldn't walk for much of my childhood, and I learned how hard that is. And my parents worried about having insurance, and I was rejected by a lot of kids. So I learned about rejection, but I also learned about how important it is to have equality and to be inclusive. And that led me to be involved in many of the social and economic and racial justice challenges of the last 30 or 40 years. The South African issue, the labor movement, climate change. I've been a leader in climate change for 30 years. Why? Because I have developed an ability with others to look into the future and say, look, if we don't do anything, here's where we're going, and we're not going to like that. If we do something, here are the extraordinary things that could happen. And what that means is what we do today really sets us up for the future. And so I am passionate to make sure that we not only address the problems of today, which include housing and healthcare and education and the poor quality of most jobs, but I also want us to be ready for the future. And that means renewable energy, better transportation, and so forth. So I'm excited, and I have to say I'm getting a tremendous reaction, and the election's coming up.
Take your life experiences, and if you will, for the audience who's going to be watching this, try and extrapolate that and mesh it into how a governor will lead and how a governor should understand the issues they're facing.
Well, first of all, a governor should have an integrated vision for where the state should go. So, for example, in Massachusetts, we have 6.8 million people. We have a lot of people who are really struggling, and the people at the top don't realize that. They can't afford their rents. They can't afford to get in a mortgage. They can't afford to start a small business. And by the way, this is really affecting the millennial population, and nobody is addressing their concerns. So an integrated vision of the future. Then you have to make the case. So one of the things I have said is I will be out there talking to business leaders. I'm a social justice candidate who started as a minister almost 40 years ago, but I did a doctorate at Harvard Business School. So I understand finance. I understand how to move things forward. So I'm someone who, when somebody says, I'm sorry, it's too expensive, we can't do it, I can say, let's go look at that. That's not true. We could invest. We could move forward. So to answer your question, helping people come together, lay out that vision. So I'll give you a couple examples. We need to focus on statewide transportation. Everywhere I have been, more than 300 communities, people say we can't move forward out in Western Mass, down on the South Coast, up on the North Shore. It's ridiculous. I was in Haverhill, 30 miles away from here, takes 90 minutes on the train. I drive out to Worcester, I get stuck in traffic, 2 hours to go 44 miles. It has gotten worse, and it's not going to be solved overnight. You need someone who understands the daily experience and the difficulty that people are having. And I could, again, touch on housing. Who can afford the rents that we're experiencing?
Let me stop you on the transportation part of it. Do you think that this governor and the past governors have focused mainly on the eastern part of the state when it comes to transportation, so that folks in Springfield and Chicopee and Fall River and Lawrence, they kind of get left behind?
So, yes, but let me start by saying we didn't focus enough on the problems of the T. So even the eastern part has had problems. But absolutely, I want us to be one Commonwealth. I want to be the people's governor. I want to move the governor's office 2 days a month to a community that feels overlooked, that has real assets, wonderful people, and yet they don't get the attention, they don't get the support. So that Eastern bias is real, and we need to correct it, because as I've been to every town that you mentioned, every city, and I see just how the enormous potential that's being held back because of that lack of investment, it's shocking. And it's tragic, but it needs to be fixed.
I asked a couple of seasons ago, or a couple of campaigns ago, I asked, I think it was the independent candidate, Evan Falchuk.
Yeah.
I asked him about the role he could see his lieutenant governor fulfilling. And it was interesting because Angus, I forgot your last name, but he was running for lieutenant governor. Mm-hmm. And it was very clear that they had almost the same sense of how the governor's office should run.
Right.
It should be out there in the field rather than ribbon cutting in the central, in Boston itself. Do you see, though, how do I pose this so it doesn't appear as though I'm slamming Somerville? Somerville was just recently the recipient of $2 billion in transportation infrastructure infusion. That was federal and state and local money. Mm-hmm. Do you see that there is an imbalance or an unfairness when it comes to advocating for that money? Somebody like Springfield coming in
No. And so it does not harm Springfield if we say we need a comprehensive transportation systems in the Boston area that really serves lower income people. Now, let's be clear about this. The Green Line runs out into the wealthiest communities in the state. It goes into Brookline, it goes into Newton, and all those folks who have a lot more resources than we do. They also have public transportation.
Mm-hmm.
Our public transportation, our trolley system was killed, and then many years ago, and now we've been left so that low-income people or regular residents or students or immigrants or all the wonderful people who live in Somerville are faced with a really significant problem just getting in and out of Boston, which we can see.
Right.
However, there is an additional problem because everyone knows that as you improve transportation, you risk gentrification. So I, and this is a
nice
problem.
Segue.
Here's the dilemma. We want our communities to improve. We want to have better open space. We want to have new housing. We want to have new businesses. But if it happens too fast, then you get displacement. You get foreclosure. Now, this is true in communities of color, in low-income communities. You know, just taking Boston, Mattapan, Roxbury, Dorchester, they're experiencing that. East Boston is a major battleground, so to speak. So without being too simplistic, part of what you need to do is slow down that transition so it doesn't happen overnight and rents don't triple overnight. You need to slow it down a bit and you need to provide for affordable housing. You need to make sure that people who are currently here are not shoved out. And that's, as you know, a very intense debate right now in Somerville.
Is that done at the state level or do you, would, as governor, you would depend on the municipalities to control the zoning and the inclusionary housing?
Well, listen, you know my wife, Ann Tate, and mm-hmm. Ann is a professor of architecture, and I can tell you we have long, fascinating conversations about zoning. You can come over to dinner and listen to them. But this zoning is a balance between the interests of the state and the interests of the local
right.
community. And, you know, so in virtually every community has its own special issues. In some cases, you need the state to provide incentives or to push a bit to increase affordable housing, to increase open space. In some cases, the community needs to really have the upper hand. And that's what politics and democracy are all about. And we've seen, as you know, political change that I support in Somerville to see that. But it's been difficult for some people who look at, honestly, I just came on Washington Street. There's four buildings on Washington Street that, you know, I can't really remember were there before. They've been built in the last couple months.
Mm-hmm.
And that's true everywhere. So, you know, it's a good thing when a community has more investment. But you have to make sure that the people who are living there benefit and not new people who push them out.
Federal government has cut back over the years on their investments into public housing,
right.
affordable housing.
Right.
They've left it up to the states. The states are slowly getting squeezed. Now it's being left up to the municipalities.
Right.
Governor Baker came up with a idea through his administration of public-private partnerships.
Yeah, yeah.
We have one of those taking place here in Somerville
right.
up at the Clarendon Hill, North Street, Clarendon Hill folks.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see that as the future for providing public housing, affordable housing?
Well,
or would you prefer to continue the state providing the funding?
So I guess the briefest answer is no. I don't see it as the future. It is one piece of the future. And the reason I say that is because and there's some good partnerships out there, but they're complicated, and there's always the tension between the developers who are looking to make a return and the highest possible return. As I mentioned, I went to business school. Here's the naked reality. When you leave housing to the market, it builds expensive housing for rich people. One of the most terrible examples of this. I'll give you two. One is we put $18 billion into building Seaport.
Mm-hmm.
That Seaport district, first of all, did nothing for the local community. No African Americans or Hispanic folks were really able to benefit. It's right next door. And secondly, what we built was a very modern, very white community that is being built in the number one most likely to flood place in the entire state. So they built it on the basis of a crazy assumption, and it's going to be, I mean, look, just this winter, we had a photo of a guy kayaking through the Seaport. So this is the example of what markets do
right.
when they are stupid,
right.
and you need leadership to say, and believe me, it would have had a big impact if I were governor then and said, you know, I just don't know how wise an investment this is. That would have put a tremor, and they would have said, well, what do you mean? What do you mean? And I would have said, well, look, what are you going to do with all that water?
Not to mix candidates who are running, but you're echoing something that Congressman Capuano said
right.
when he was on the show.
Right.
he was worried about the economic impact of the Seaport District with all the investment, and right. now it's going to fall to the government to try to figure out sea level rise. His concern is mainly about Logan Airport. What happens if we lose Logan Airport, that hub of that driver of our economy there? So
I have to say, Congressman Capuano is very thoughtful about these questions. There's two things. Logan Airport will be protected because it has military value, right? So they eventually will build a wall around it of some kind. It'd be expensive. It's stupid that we have to do it. But here's an added thing. There's 40,000 people living right next door. And when I was actually out at Logan Airport speaking to Massport a number of years ago, I said, what happens when there's a massive flood and the 40,000 people in East Boston come walking into the airport looking to be rescued? And she had no idea. So that's an example of, and you know, East Boston used to be five islands. It's heading back toward five islands. But look, Joe, the larger issue here is that you need someone who can imagine a bold future. And I want to tell you something. I'll tell you something that's exciting and then something that's disturbing. What's exciting is that if you look around the world, you see that many countries have addressed these problems, have solutions, and we are in this bubble that we think, well, we're Massachusetts, so we must be at the best at everything. But let me give you an example. Denmark, which is the same size as Massachusetts, already at 50% offshore wind driving their electricity. What does that mean? Much lower costs, protecting the planet, the ability to electrify transportation. We don't have that. Now, let me ask you, if you are an international company looking to come, are you going to come to a place that has crappy transportation, expensive fossil fuel, and people who are undereducated and so forth, like we're headed towards? Or are you going to go to some place that has all of that stuff? So that's the mistake that we're making. On the other side, though, if we get busy now, Massachusetts, of course, has so many advantages. But we don't have the leadership that understands what is possible. I mean, I'll tell you, the gap between what we could be doing and what we are doing has never been bigger.
I think the voters who are watching this one are getting a sense for your passion on these issues. So
I got more.
So let me ask you, you know, you've been traveling most of the year. You've been doing your congratulations on the convention.
Thank you.
So what is the central issue that these voters, I know the issues change from section to section, but what is the central theme that the voters are worried about today, whether it's local or statewide or national?
I think it's their quality of life today and in the future. So, look, we grew up, you and I certainly grew up in that post-war period when everyone thought we are living the American dream. And what does that mean? It means that we have institutions and we have a free market system, which has some real advantages, but we can work hard and at the end we'll have a retirement and we'll have something to show for it. Maybe we'll own our own home, but even better, our kids will do even better than that. They'll go to college. That's why we're worried. They'll have a home. Their kids will do better. That has stopped. So again, coming back to the millennial generation, there aren't those same jobs. So they're going out there, they're trying to find it, and they're coming back and having to go home. So the fundamental issue is the economy is no longer doing what it needs to do for most people. But here's the problem. The folks at the top, the business leaders, the political leaders, the people who hang out all the time on Beacon Hill, they haven't gotten the memo. Mm-hmm. I have. I mean, every single place I've gone, people have come to me. So honestly, you know, that's one reason why I think I'm the better candidate. My opponent is suggesting that his experience on Beacon Hill is the thing that reason people should support him. I'm proud that I don't have experience on Beacon Hill. I have experience building national organizations, international organizations. I've brought big pensions funds in to work with activists in order to move companies forward. I'm not anti-business at all, but I think our democracy is getting overwhelmed by some industries, big pharma, big banks, big oil, and you need political leaders to push back against that. Charlie is baby steps Baker. He takes a little bit, you know, a few things, But what's, you
did
know what?
Did you just coin that here on this
no,
show?
No, no, I've used it before, but okay. I haven't.
I thought I had an exclusive there, Bob.
No, but I don't often use it, but right now when we're talking about what his style is, and Joe, listen, this is the thing that's amazing to me. He's been governor for 3.5 years. Not only did he not come out to any of the marches, the women's march, the gun violent march, didn't show up. What's a governor supposed to do when tens of thousands? Didn't show up, didn't make a statement. Has never held an open public meeting where regular folks, like the folks from Somerville, could ask him any question. Now, what's he afraid of? This guy has walled himself up. He's running commercials about what a great guy he is. But I want to ask the people, do you really feel you're doing better than you were 4 years ago? That's that old question from politics. You know, you've been told you can't have a better education. It's going to be too expensive. You can't have better housing. That's not true. What you need is leadership to, first of all, inspire people to move forward, push them, and then, if necessary, require them. And that's where you get into the tougher part of politics.
You made reference, you know, to the fact that you've seen the show before, and know that I try to be fair and equal to everybody who comes on here.
Yeah.
So there have been Republican candidates, Democratic candidates, and you name it. Everyone's been in here. The one candidate that has never even responded, and I don't say this, this is fact, is Charlie Baker. His campaign has never reached out to Access Television, as far as I can see.
I mean,
see.
Joe.
But let me ask you the question.
This is common.
What explains his 70% or 68% positive rating in the state?
So a couple things explain it. First of all, the numbers are fake. And what I mean by that is that first of all, it's a Republican polling firm called Morning Consult. And their purpose is to show that Republican governors are popular. That's why they exist. Secondly, they say, do you think the governor's doing a very good job or a somewhat good job? Now, somewhat is pretty good, but they take very and somewhat combine it and say, wow, he's super popular. No. And the third thing is, in 2010, Charlie Baker lost when he was running against Deval Patrick because people said he was mean. All right. So what did he learn? I want to run again. I want to make sure I'm nice. So he has had a misleading I'm nice campaign. He has supported Donald Trump on immigration issues. He supported Donald Trump he's raising money for Donald Trump. He is laundering money right now for himself. What do I mean by that? We have $1,000 limits. He's raising $43,000 a pop donations for the Republican National Committee and for the Governor's Association. People don't know that. Do people know that he's raising money for Donald Trump? Who's he going to vote for in 2020? Is he going to vote for Donald Trump?
Has he ever disclosed who he voted for in the last election?
Yes. What he said was he didn't vote for anybody. And therefore, think about it. That means he knows that he's in the laser focus of Donald Trump, and that's why he doesn't want to say anything or do anything or show up at any rally.
He's kind of on a razor's edge.
He is on a razor's edge. I sometimes say he's straddling a barbed wire fence, and you can only do that for so long.
Don't slip, Charlie.
Yeah, don't slip, Charlie.
Your top
priorities. But I'm poking him.
Your top priorities. I know you are so passionate on the environment. You're passionate on corporate oversight.
I'm passionate for people. I just have to tell you, I want to be the people's
because
donor.
It all flows down.
It
to
all
how
does.
Somebody's
the mistakes made by these people, or the deliberate decisions made by the people who are so far away, we don't know who they are and what they do. They trickle down and they hammer us. And I just want to make clear. I love living in Somerville. I've been here since the mid '80s. It is a wonderful community, and you know, so diverse, so extraordinary, so creative. I've always felt if we can fix a problem in Somerville, we probably can fix it anywhere. I'll tell you, I was walking through Artbeat. I thought, this is a kind of heaven. All these wonderful people, but I see people getting hit hard here. Mm-hmm. I see people getting hit hard in Jamaica Plain and all over the towns that you mentioned. And there's no reason for that. It's a failure of leadership and a failure to understand how the economy actually works. So I'm actually presenting myself as understands the economy better than those folks who are running it, and because they don't understand what the impacts are.
Forgive my naivete here, but if you are successful and you take the governor's seat, Charlie Baker made some drastic cuts to Health and Human Services. Right. Can you restore those?
So yes, but the first piece that we have to do is realize that everybody on Beacon Hill either is actively lying or has been forced to overlook. Our revenue system is broken. So that's, I mean, so we are at least $2 billion short every single year, and we've used every gimmick, but that's why the schools don't have enough. That's why our roads and bridges are crumbling. That's why we can't invest in transportation. So the first thing in my inaugural address is going to say we need to have a new understanding of what an economy is, of how a democracy works, and we need to rethink revenue. And I believe in progressive taxation. I supported the Fair Share Amendment. And what does that mean? It means that people who are making a ton of money deserve to pay more, should pay more, because we live in a single commonwealth where when one of us benefits, we all benefit. And that principle has been lost. California did this. California actually got greater revenue from their higher, their very high income. They're now prospering. They have extra money. They've funded all their programs. So we have to do the revenue piece, and then we restore the cuts.
A little bit about the education system. Recently there was a report. Massachusetts education system, public education system, is ranked at the high end.
Yeah.
What else can we do to prepare those young people coming through our public education system for success?
Yeah, so we are being misled by those numbers, and of course I'm proud that we're doing that, but that's from a certain kind of test, the MCAS, which I'll tell you, the MCAS is amazing in that it has managed to unify everybody in hating it. Teachers hate it, parents hate it, kids hate it, and we're not even sure that what it shows is what we want. And even more important, it is damaging classrooms because people are forced to teach to the test. So I've heard from teachers, students, families, everybody, we need to back up and actually say, what are the skills we need? Obviously math and other things, but we also need to train people for the 21st century economy, and our testing doesn't do it. And again, I have seen, let me show you, the healthcare system. I want to move to a single payer system, which would lower our cost. That would help education. How does that work? Because school committees are forced to put more and more and more money into the rising healthcare costs, and they don't have the money to invest in their schools. Plus, the legislature has just recently failed to pass a revision of our education budget, which we've needed for years. The governor should have stepped in and said, I want this 25-year broken formula to be fixed. He let it fail, and that's going to damage schools across the state for another 2 years. How can you defend that? So I think if people knew that, they would say, this is a guy who hasn't addressed the opioid crisis, who hasn't worked on education, who has no real plan on healthcare, no real plan on housing. What's the guy doing? I don't think we can afford to have him for four more years. I think we would be stuck.
Single payer healthcare system. Let me just, one of the former Democratic candidates for governor, Don Berwick, was on the show. He talked about single payer. I'm not so sure the Massachusetts voting electorate understands single payer.
I think you're right, and because it's very complicated. But here's what they do understand. I am not sure how long I'm going to have my health insurance. I'm paying too much for my deductibles. I'm paying too much for my premiums. I don't get adequate coverage. I don't know what happens if I lose my job. You know, my cousin is this or my mother is that. People feel very nervous about where this is going to go, and that's because they're being used as ping pong balls by different companies. We need to fix that.
It is a larger issue. It's a national issue. It's a local issue. Before we go any further, Bob Massie, 2018.com.
And that's M-A-S-S-I-E. Bob, M-A-S-S. It's like Massachusetts. And September 4th, Joe, I hope you'll, September 4th is the critical primary, and it's a stupid day, but we need you to vote. And that's the day after Labor Day, September 4th. You can register to vote up until August 15th, and then I hope you'll go out, because if I'm going to win, it's not by much. And if you think this kind of bold action is what you want, I'm going to need your vote. I would love to have it.
There you go. And he took away the pitch from me. Watch the PSA later on. But everyone knows who watches this show how passionate I am about voting.
Yeah.
On
yeah.
September 4th, please remember to vote. The constitutional offices here in Massachusetts are up for grabs, as well as Congress and some county seats. My sincere thanks to Bob Massie, candidate for governor of Massachusetts. Please remember to vote. As always, stay safe, stay informed. We'll see you the next time.
We love you, Somerville.